You know, it's always nice when I get to shine a spotlight on some of the other people I share this website with, and one particular group I've been itching to talk about for a bit is, believe it or not, VTubers. Yeah, you know, VTubers. Those live streamers that use 2.5D models to represent themselves instead of a webcam, they're pretty big right now. I mean, maybe not as much as they were a couple years ago, but I wanted to cover them in some fashion. The only problem was that, for a while, I just wasn't sure how I was going to. I tossed some ideas around, brainstormed a little, mostly with myself, so not very productive. Eventually, I just decided to screw it and figured that the only right way to tribute them was also the simplest. And that was to go through and review every single Hololive member from all three English generations, and you know what? Let's throw Holotempest in there just for fun. Oh yeah, we're really doing this. You knew what you were signing up for when you saw the title and the length of this video. We're past the point of no return now. One tiny note before we begin, I know Holostar's English just debuted a new generation and it might be seen as only fair that I include them, but I'm not going to, and I'm likely just gonna make an addendum to this video later down the line for two main reasons. One, I wanna have a fighting chance at finishing this video this year, and I'm not gonna if I have to keep postponing it anytime something changes. And two, I gotta give the new guys at least a couple more months to settle in before I judge them too harshly. So grab your shovels and your riggers, cause it's a long way down the VTuber rabbit hole. But not that deep, cause I'm only talking about Hololive in this video. And only the English branch at that rate. But I needed a hook for the intro, so what are you gonna do? Before we can start fully, I first have to lay out some of the basics for how this video is gonna go. First, I'm gonna assume anyone watching this has at least a cursory knowledge of VTubers in general and Hololive specifically. If you have no idea what either of those things are, who any of these people are, or perhaps most concerningly of all to someone in your possession, why in God's name they're so popular, this video is not here to answer those questions. If you'd like a resource that does just that, there are many others that do the job much better than I am willing to right now. Sorry. Secondly, keep in mind, a lot of this video is based around personal opinion, personal preference, personal bias, personal everything. It's a very personal video. What I mean by that is, I don't have time to watch every single Hololive streamer in existence, even the English ones. I mean, do you know how much of a time investment that is? So, undoubtedly, there will be some talents in this video that I will know less about, and will find it harder to form a strong opinion on since, simply put, I haven't watched them as much. Also, please understand, I do not hate or even outright dislike any of the members in this video. I may be critical at some points, and I may not love everyone featured, but I certainly don't hate them as entertainers and definitely not as people. I mean, how could I hate someone I don't even know? To try and aim for some level of consistency and cohesion, I'll be treading very similar ground for each member. Things like their design, voice, and lore are all shared aspects that people like to point to for reasons they prefer one idol over the other, and any additional information I wish to opine on will be included as well. I'm generally going to keep my analysis pretty loose. I'm not here to give the official Hololive seal of approval to anyone. I'm just here to tell you what I think. Everybody got that? Good. Seeing as how this is a personal video, what better way to truly start than by personally breaking down my personal history with how I personally discovered Hololive English. Personally. Like all great stories, this one begins with the Game Grumps. No, I'm not fact-checking that. I've already made several videos about the Grumps and their associated acts, but around maybe late 2022 to early 2023, I actually fell off the Game Grumps wagon a little and stopped watching them regularly. With the Game Grumps now being out of my regular rotation of content creators, I had a gap that desperately needed filling. Gaming. GG had been my main source of that kind of video content, and now I had a big gaping hole in my viewing habits, which they once occupied. What was I gonna fill it with? That's when a light bulb was set off and I remembered, hey, aren't there those VTuber things I've been hearing about? They play video games, why don't I give them a shot? And so it was. Right around early to mid 2023, I started watching Hall Live English like it was my job. I'd watch clips, animations, VODs, I'd even catch the occasional stream while it was live. That's true fandomship right there. And despite me not having any personal hangups or skepticism over the idea of VTubing in general, I was struck by how accessible and easy to watch and grasp the concept of these channels were. It suddenly didn't seem so impenetrable or esoteric anymore. It just seemed like something anyone could enjoy, if they were willing to give it a chance. I gave them my chance, and I don't regret it. But enough about me. Let's dig into who this is really about. The year is 2020. It is a dark time for the human race. Tensions are rising, disease and mass death are rampant, and society itself is on the brink of collapse. In these trying times, we need a savior. We need heroes. We need something, someone to look up to. And then there was Myth. Hollow Myth debuted in September of 2020 with 5 members under the label. As the name would suggest, the theme around this group is that they were all inspired by or otherwise meant to depict mythical beings like the Phoenix, the Grim Reaper, and a shark? Or how about just a regular human? Or another regular human that fused with a Lovecraftian entity and turned into a hentai monster. Alright, so it wasn't a perfect analogy, but people didn't seem to care. Myth still debuted to enormous success, taking off in what seemed like the blink of an eye, and to this day, the 5 members remain the most subscribed to in the entirety of Hololive English, with the lowest sub count of the bunch still having over 500,000 more than that of the closest runner-up, and the highest tipping the scales at over 4 million. In case you were unaware, 4 million subscribers in just 3 years is, in mathematical terms, fucking insane. But numbers aren't everything. How does the actual group themselves hold up to scrutiny? Is there really something there beneath their cute exteriors? Or was it just a right place, right time sort of deal? Let's dig deeper. All 5 Myth members debuted one after the other beginning on September 12th, 2020. Mori Calliope was the first to go live, with Amelia Watson closing things out. In between, we had Takanashi Kiara, Ninomai Inanis, and Gargura's individual streams, followed by a collaboration stream hosted the following day. I'm going based off my time zone, by the way, so if some of the dates are a little off, that's why. Now, even though Gura was the 4th to debut, I'm gonna talk about her first. Why? Well, as disheartening as it may be to hear, VTubing is not a mainstream thing. It is, as of right now, still a cult medium. So while plenty of VTubers both in and outside of Hololive are well known within these niche circles, very few have been able to break through into the mass public consciousness in the same way some bigger YouTubers have. And while I don't think she's quite there yet herself, Gura is still probably the closest thing VTubers have to a household name. To me, it only makes sense to start with her since she's one of the first VTubers most people hear about, and was how a lot of people were introduced to the idea, at least in the West. So, who is Gargura in canon? Well, that's actually pretty easy to answer. Simply put, she's a shark girl. I mean, there's a bit more to it than that. Apparently she's also from Atlantis, but for all intents and purposes, that's most of what you need to know about her from a lore standpoint. Well, really, you don't need to know anything about her lore in order to enjoy her or any of the other streamers, but in case you were curious and the tale didn't tip you off already, Shark Girl. She's also, all cards on the table, easily one of my favorite members in Hololive English. I don't entirely know why, but the best way I can put it is that she seems to embody the best version of all the things that you can come to expect from VTubers, making even the stuff that I don't always like as much somehow work whenever she does it. I used to not particularly care for character voices in VTubers, you know, when they do a cute high-pitched voice instead of just talking normally. I originally didn't like it, but I've now come to be able to tolerate them and even begrudgingly admit that they can enhance the experience at times. I still overall prefer it when VTubers use voices that are closer to how they naturally sound, but I acknowledge that one is not inherently better than the other, and a big stepping stone on my road to getting to that mindset was Gura. One of the other things that I love so much about Gura is just how adaptable she is and how well she plays off everyone she interacts with. Usually in Hall Alive, I have my ideal pairings or ideal groups of people I think work better together than they do with anyone else. I don't really feel that way with Gura. She is just instantly compatible with whoever you put her with. The word often used in this context is chemistry, and if that's what we're rolling with, then there is an instant chemical reaction every time Gura collabs with one or more of her genmates, or just anyone, really. But even by herself, Gura is just so insanely entertaining, which really is a credit to her abilities, because having to carry an entire stream by yourself is really difficult. It's a huge weight to be lifted off one's shoulders, I'd imagine, to have someone else around to take on some of the responsibility of entertaining the viewers. And being the only one who can do it must be a daunting task, but Gura just has it. God, it really kind of flows like its own little narrative, doesn't it? About how, in a world with time-traveling detectives, Lovecraftian entities, mythical creatures arriving in our dimension, and death herself, all it took was one spunky little shark to rise to the challenge and blaze past all of them. How she doesn't let it all get to her head, I have no idea, but she's still the same Gooba we met at the beginning, and likewise, she's one of my favorites. VTuber rating, 9 out of 10.
Why did my eyes go to your comment? Revolted, of all things!
You entered your fire point. Well, yeah, well, they're closer than your mom and dad will ever be.
Mori Kali Calliope is the second most subscribed member of Hollow Myth. By the way, I'm going in order of sub count for Myth. I probably could have just said that instead of whatever spiel I went on about Gura. And like with Gooba, she's one of the most recognizable members, as far as I can tell, and that's actually a really good thing. I'm serious, I could not think of two better people to be the de facto faces of Hollow Live English. Why? Well, they're very different from one another. So if one isn't your style, then the next one over might be more to your liking. Alright, so what's Callie's deal? Long story short, she's the Grim Reaper. I mean, she's not exactly the Grim Reaper, she's more like the apprentice to the Reaper, but she's got a scythe, she lives, unlives in the underworld. Grim Reaper, she's the Grim Reaper. Now, with as out there a backstory as that, you'd expect her personality to match. No. Out of all the Myth members and possibly HoloEN in general, Kelly sometimes feels like the most normal one of the bunch, which is not a bad thing. In a group mainly composed of screaming, larger-than-life characters, having something of a balancing element, a straight man, or straight feminine demon, is actually very useful as a way to somewhat corral the other members. It makes Kelly feel more accessible and easier to approach to outsiders, as opposed to someone like Ame, who is a bit more of an acquired taste. I like her, I think she's an important piece of what makes Myth work, and dispels the notion that normal or everyman-ish equates to boring or unremarkable. And, like, obviously she's not like that all the time. She gets her opportunities to fly off the rails and be crazy like everyone else, but a lot of her funniest moments I find come from her reacting to what the other members around her are doing. Everything down to her voice, which is one of the deeper and more natural sounding cadences in HoloEN, is a far cry from many other members with quite high-pitched sounds that are very obviously just affectations. Kelly tried to do something like that early on, but I'm glad she phased it out fairly quickly, as her normal voice is more than enough given the kind of personality she comes across as. It can also be nice from a personal point of view to have someone in the roster who can echo my thoughts sometimes, particularly with how unhinged so many of the other members are. Having someone there to remind me that I'm not crazy with my response of, "What? What did she just say?" is helpful. I do sometimes feel like I'm just a bit too sane to be a part of this fanbase, so it's nice to have someone there to set me straight. I really can't find much to complain about with Kali. I like her Gura-esque ability to pair well with just about anyone. I love how much she collabed with the Tempest Boys when they were around, but I'll be saving that for much later in the video. And I tolerate Takamori, which I'll be saving for less late in the video. VTuber rating, 8 out of 10.
Marky Rodriguez. Chris Noiros. My friend plays the recorder better. Hey, fuck your friend!
Amelia Watson is certainly one of the more, interesting members in Hololive English. In some ways, she feels like the most individual or independent one of Holomyth. Like, she's more of her own thing divorced from the Hololive brand when compared to her genmates, which is due to her idiosyncrasies and not only her persona, but also her lore, background, design, and general presentation. Speaking of which, just what are those anyway? Amelia Watson is the detective whose surname is an obvious reference to Dr. Watson of Sherlock Holmes fame. Although she does possess a time-controlling pocket watch, thus giving her some kind of power, Amelia stands out from her genmates for being the only fully human member of Myth. Emphasis on fully, I'll be coming back to that. And this gives her an interesting dynamic with the others, as she has to rely more on her smarts and willpower rather than raw strength or supernatural abilities, which oddly runs parallel to some of the difficulties Watson faced in the real world. When starting off her investigation, Ame had arguably the most amount of roadblocks she had to overcome when compared to her genmates. Mainly, she couldn't sing. I say couldn't in the past tense because she actually has improved in this area in the past few years, but when she started, she was completely tone deaf. Despite that deficiency, Ame was able to play to her own personal strengths and was instrumental in the creation of these small Hololive models. Whatever, I'm just saying it as it's spelt, which were used in the Myth 1 year anniversary stream and would go on to become a famous bit of iconography forever attached to Hololive. She also had another runaway success with the legs on the table trend that really took off and is now considered a staple of many VTubers' repertoire. In general, Ame seems like one of the most unique, talented, and proactive members in the entirety of Hololive English, and I want to acknowledge that immediately, and how it totally overshadows the fact that I don't love her. Now hold your horses, ladies, gents, and so on and so forth. You might have misheard me. For those in the back who didn't quite catch it, I said I don't love Ame. Not that I don't like her, because of course I do. I like all the Holo-EN members for their own reasons. But when forced to look through the pantheon and contemplate which ones I felt stood high and above all the rest, I found Ame coming up a bit short. For one thing, I think her voice can be kind of annoying. Be aware that I said can be, not is. I mean, I'm already not a super big fan of exaggerated voices in VTubers anyway, and when Ame is just talking, it's usually fine, but what I don't like are those times where she kind of whisper yells. It's hard to describe. It's like that thing you did when you were a kid and you wanted to scream, but also didn't want to wake up your parents, so you kind of try to sound like you wanted to yell, but didn't actually. I also don't tend to watch her roll solo as much as I do with people like Gura. Not for any particularly in-depth reason, but I find it funny that someone who I described as being the most individual member of Myth is also the one I watch the least of by herself. That said though, one thing I will commend Ame for that I actually like a lot is something I don't hear people reference as much. The bait and switch. By that, I mean when you first hear about Ame and how she's the most human member of Myth, you might anticipate her being a little more straight arrow, more subdued perhaps than some of her collaborators. But no, Ame's crazy, and as sort of an inverse of Kali, I think having that juxtaposition is not only interesting, but also adds to the variety. I'll say as much that Ame is generally someone I admire more than I actually watch a lot, and I will admit, the more I learned about her and the more I've seen how far she, in particular, has come since she first started, the more I like her. I definitely appreciate how much she's brought to the table, even if she doesn't entirely click with me personally. But who knows, maybe one day I'll come around to really adoring her like I do some of the others. For right now though, I still can't see myself scoring her any lower than a VTuber rating of out of 10.
To smash blocks or enemies below you or to flatten out bumps in the road, nothing beats a ground pound. That's funny, cause you guys know that's actually what I did to your mom last night.
Believe it or not, I do have reason to suspect I will one day come around to Ame and actually have her really gel with me. It's because it's happened before. Ninomai Inanis is likely the member of Myth I've been on the biggest journey with when it comes to my opinion. For the longest time, I didn't think much of her. She just didn't appeal to me particularly, but that likely had a lot to do with me not watching her as much as some of the others. Since then, I've given Ina more of a shot, which has resulted in me really reevaluating my thoughts on her, to the point where I now consider her an absolute first-rate chef's kiss member. When it comes to her lore, Ina is another mostly human member of myth, but unlike Ame, still has a link back to something supernatural. In this case, she's the priestess for a Fortean entity simply known as the Ancient Ones, which, if I'm being honest, is a pretty bland moniker that I don't think this IP can quite get away with. I mean, isn't it a little bold to assume the lore of Hollow Myth is just so grand and epic that it need not waste time with pithy things such as giving the Ancient Ones a more descriptive title? Whatever, it's not really important. What matters is Ina herself, and to sum her up, well, I actually don't have a word for her. I don't even have a group of words commonly referred to as a sentence. Instead of all that, I'm just going to show you this picture. See that face? That look of utter contentment and satisfaction? Let that set the tone perfectly. Now, if I were to put words to that image, the fandom would at least have my back, because a descriptor I have often heard used to apply to her streams and overall character is comfy, and I think that's a fitting term. A common theme you'll hear me coming back to is variety. After all, if you're gonna have a sizable roster full of various different talents, you better have a reason for them to be so numerous. And to me, the main benefit is the vast differences from one member to the other. Ina being so laid back and subdued is a big part of why she's so popular, and again, her popularity is something I really didn't give credence to when first getting into Hololive. Looking back, it seems so bizarre that she ever just faded into the lineup for me, when now I get the impression she's one of the most well-liked members in all of Hollow-E-N. Sure, everyone has their fans, but it seems to me that nobody dislikes Ina. She's got it all. An interesting design, simple yet striking, an easy to listen to voice that's recognizable without being grating, and impressive artistic abilities that show that she's not just some hack who stumbled into success. She actually does something worth praising. I honestly don't have much else to say. If anything, I should have just let this Takodachi art stay here for a few minutes and you basically all would have gotten the impression. And again, I'm glad me finding more to like about Ina as time went on has given me reason to not give up on Ame, as the same thing might happen with her. For now though, Ina-ness is Ina-nice. Oh yeah, did I mention Ina likes puns? As if she couldn't get any better. VTuber rating.
Wow.
Out of 10.
Ina of the floor, what is your wisdom? Donuts.
And now, as we begin to close out the first chapter of our Hololive English journey, you'd best prepare yourself, as things are about to get hot. As in, like, it'll generate heat. Because Kiara is a phoenix? What'd you think I meant? Takanashi Kiara is, in fact, a phoenix, and in the Hololive universe, phoenixes work a little differently than the conventional conception. Instead of simply rising from the ashes of their previous incarnation, phoenixes instead reincarnate in another dimension, and Kiara has been transported into ours, and is now the manager of KFP. Kentucky Fried Phoenix, get it, like KFC, hilarious, right? Okay, moving on. One thing about Kiara that makes me like her right off the bat is her genuine high energy. It's commonplace now for people to mock the standard popular YouTube formula, with the loud, obnoxious, over-the-top character used to grab the creator's very young audience's very short attention span with random loud noises. It's vapid and pointless, and it works, so it's not going anywhere, but this isn't meant to be a negative video, and I'm only bringing this up to praise Kiara for not falling into that trap by having her energy and expressiveness come off as more real. It just doesn't feel manufactured or inauthentic in any way. She kind of reminds me of Jacksepticeye in that regard. It's that loud, hyped up persona that you'd think would get grating, but for me personally, if it's coming from a place of sincerity and gives the impression that it's just who they are, I really don't have a problem with high energy people in general, online or off. Plus, she knows how to turn it down when needed. As for what else Kiara has going on, she's in a possibly romantic relationship with Callie, on stream that is. I don't have any reason to believe this is anything more than a bit, but if it's not, I guess I'll eat my words on this one. There's also that weird-ass mother-daughter thing she has with Kobo, who's not in Hololive English, so I won't be covering her in this video. I don't know how to feel whenever I see stuff like this pop up, because on the subject, this is a common trend I noticed in a lot of Hololive streamers, a willingness to play the audience's game, which I'm not entirely sure is a good or a bad thing. I mean, on one hand, establishing yourself as someone who doesn't snap back at their viewers and even co-signs them to an extent can set a, ill-advised precedent, but on the other hand, it is nice to see a creator who you get the sense actually likes the people who watch them. Don't take it for granted, we're in short supply. And on that note, I'll just say that on the whole, I really like Kiara too. I think she's very entertaining, both by herself and paired with other talents. She's funny and she's energized, and while the latter trait might not appeal to everyone, as I said, it doesn't feel forced, it just feels like herself. And I'll always have respect for someone who's just willing to be themselves. VTuber rating, little shit, out of 10.
Are you sure you got it a middle finger? Gross! No. Peace, love, and harmony in this classroom.
Overall, to say that Hololive English hit the ground running would be an understatement. Overviewing each of the members and actually talking about what makes each of them great in their own right made me appreciate just how much of a strong start Myth was. But, of course, this was only the beginning for Hololive English. Several more branches were on their way in the future, but would any of them be able to measure up to the five originals? There's only one way to find out. Following the surprise hit that was HoloMyth, it seemed only natural that future HoloEN members would follow in their footsteps, and soon enough, they did! One did. One arrived before all the other ones did. I'm sure Cover Corporation had their reasons. Iris, no last name, Madonna style, wow that's a dated reference, debuted solo on July 10th, 2021, less than a year after Myth made their entrance. Being the first new member to debut after Myth and seeing as she had no genmates to back her up at the time, no one really knew what to expect from Iris leading up to her debut. Would she be able to adequately match Myth? Would she upstage them? Would she pale in comparison? Who knew? Who cared? Comparison is the thief of joy. Regardless, let's see how Iris stacks up, starting again with her lore. Iris is a Nephilim, which in the Holoverse are half-demon, half-angels, and in contrast to biblical Nephilims, which are described as large and brutish, Iris is... not those things. Iris is characterized by her unbreakable attachment to hope in all its forms, and has descended upon our planet to deliver said hopium to all of us in our time of need. She, of course, achieved this by live-streaming her playing video games. Whatever works. I really want to love Iris, because she has so many things worth liking that I find it hard to believe I don't see her as one of my absolute favorites. Her designs are fantastic, both of them. Sure, the nose in the first model looked kinda weird, and that and the shading made her look a little out of place when compared to the rest of the crew, but thankfully those issues were rectified in her 2.0 design, which shot her up the ranks to become one of the best designs in Hololive English for me. I also really like her voice. It almost sounds like her natural speaking voice, but with just a little bit of characterful flair to make it more recognizable. It's not overdone or distracting, and it sounds wonderful. The only thing really missing from Iris is that she's a tad nondescript when compared to some of the others, particularly when she streams solo. I'll admit, I tend to like collab streams more than solo ones anyway, since I think having other personalities to bounce off of tend to bring out the best in, well, anyone. Still, if a VTuber is entertaining enough, I might check them out even when it's them alone, because their personality is just that strong. I don't tend to do that with Iris. When she's in a group, she's fine. Hell, she actually gets some of the best moments depending on who she's collabing with. By herself, though? I don't know. She's alright, but there's nothing really pulling me in her direction when compared to anyone else. There's nothing to dislike about her, but she doesn't appeal to me as much as the others. And there's nothing wrong with that. Okay, actually, wait, there is something Iris has going for her more than the others. She can pull off yabai moments better than anyone. For those not in the know-how, yabai is a common Japanese phrase often translated as meaning bad or dangerous, but is more colloquially used in the VTuber fandom to denote moments of vulgar or crude humor, which is seen as uncharacteristic of idol-esque performers. When others do it, it can sometimes come off as a bit forced and maybe even a little uncomfortable, but Iris just has a way with it that makes it really funny. It's the one thing I can say she has that no one does better than her, so I only find it appropriate that I award her a VTuber rating of Yabiris out of 10.
Oh man, I feel great, except I don't. I feel like ass. Just so you guys know, I don't feel very good right now, but that's okay because I have my two beautiful co-hosts to have fun with all of us today.
I'm touching Callie's butt.
Hololive Council, later rechristened as Hololive Promise, the second full generation of Hololive English, debuted in August of 2021, only about a month and a half after Iris's debut. Again, I have to question the logic behind that. Was Iris really meant as nothing more than a teaser member to gear fans up for the real big debut? If so, ouch. If not, then why the choice to split them up like that? Is there some clause that a generation can't have more than 5 members? Was Iris's concept too different from the rest to have her debuting alongside them make sense? I legitimately don't know, and I'm not being rhetorical when I ask these questions. If anyone knows the answer, I'm all ears. In any event, Council debuted and pretty successfully assimilated into the existing lineup. Fans were excited to see this new entire generation, 5 whole members, interacting and collaborating with the others they had grown so fond of over the past year. While I doubt there was any attitude that Myth on their own were becoming stale by this point, this was still a great way to spice up the roster and inject new life into the expanding world of Hololive English. Council's gimmick within the lore is that they're all meant to either watch over, or perhaps just physically depict, certain fundamental aspects of existence. I know, a pretty lofty backdrop to hang goofy live streaming antics off of, but it's part of the fun, alright? We got the guardians of space, nature, civilization, chaos, and the Warden of Time. Why she's the Warden and not the Guardian like everyone else doesn't matter because... Now, I'll start off this one by getting Hollow Council my good graces right away and stating that I really like Crony and would probably place her high up as one of my favorite members in Hollow EM. Her voice is just pitch perfect, pun intended, and is part of why I don't see the need for character voices 90% of the time, because someone like hers is just so perfect all on its own, even if it can sound a little text-to-speechy at times.
Emotional damage.
It also functions as a nice juxtaposition, as her calm, neutral voice contrasts what is actually one of the more hot-headed members in Hololive. Her design is also really cool. Dare I say, even perfect. I love the amount of blue featured, and how it contrasts with the black and silver, and it's nice to have another member with a darker color palette. I like vibrant colors, but I also like variety, and any attempt at mixing things up is gonna get big ups from me. Now, by this point, Hololive English definitely must have had some kind of quality standard when it came to the audio-visual presentation of their talents, so you'd hope it would be top tier. For the rest of Crony, we're gonna have to strap in, because she is an experience. Let's start simple by quickly going over who she is in canon. Heads up, I'm gonna be using the original Council lore for these sections. The Promise versions aren't that different anyway, just slightly tweaked. Crony is the Warden of Time. She's the controller, overseer, upper management, whatever term works best. As such, one of her most recognizable design features is the giant clock hovering behind her head in, well, her original design, which is my preferred look for her anyway over her casual outfit. Neither are bad, it's just personal taste. Also, her overview explains that since time is so precise and all-seeing, the Warden of it is perfect. I mean, that's quite the reputation to live up to, but don't worry, I'd say she gave it her best shot. Crony is hilarious. She's got this awesome, wry sense of humor that's something kinda different for Hololive English. Usually, much as I love them, some of the other talents can seem a bit juvenile, which I have no problem with, but again, the variation must flow, so having someone who's a bit more on the jaded side is a welcome addition. The whole perfect shtick is something that feels more perpetuated by the fans than anything. I mean, Crony has her fair share of moments where the joy is derived from sheer schadenfreude, but that's not a constant thing, and there's enough clips of her getting the last laugh that makes it all balance out. She's endlessly watchable no matter who you pair her with, which is an honor bestowed on only the very best in my eyes. That alone shoots her up near Callie and Grit here, though what's holding her back from there is that I'm not sure how much I watch of her by herself. In summary, Crony is one of the most well-rounded members in the entire lineup. You can laugh at her, you can laugh with her, either way, you'll probably be laughing. She's another one of those that just has it all. Well, almost anyway, but, you know, if I was her, I wouldn't sweat it. Nobody's perfect. Oh, not everyone has near infinite time on their hands to watch every Hall live streamer in existence. Good on anyone who doesn't, you must have a life. So if you've only got time for a handful, or maybe even just one, Crony's pretty high on my list of recommendations. VTuber rating, perfect out of 10.
Moist.
Ugh.
Also, remember when I described Crony as an experience a bit ago? Well, Council said, double your pleasure, double your... How'd the quote go again? Alright, I forgot. Nanashi Mume is the guardian of civilization, a seemingly wholesome barn owl with a voice that eerily echoes that of another Hololive star, and a muted palate that is, once again, against type for this point in the chronology. But beneath all that benign exterior lies a force darker, more sinister, more foreboding than anything anyone could have imagined, and nah, I'm just fucking with you, she's not that scary. I mean, she's a tad unhinged, but nowhere near what people talk her up as. Hopefully I'm not tempting fate. Anyway, Mume's pretty cool. She reminds me of Ame in the sense that, on the surface, she might not seem like the most out there or mental member of the roster, but if you lean in a little more, you'll come to find that she's just nuts in the best ways possible. I know I already said people talk up that aspect of her a little bit, but I get where it comes from. While I just compared her to Ame, in some ways, I like Mume a little more. She totes the line of energized and obnoxious very well, and never gets overbearing or reaches a point where I don't want to listen to her. Her voice is... interesting. The obvious thing to point out would be that some people think she sounds similar to Gura, but I really don't hear it that often, except for certain isolated incidents that people act like are way more common than they are. I know, I'm such a brave whistleblower. I really like Mume's colors. To my knowledge, she has probably the most earthy tones of the entire lot. Even her main outfit isn't overly colorful, but I think that's for the best. Council, or Promise, I'm used to saying Council, is a pretty technicolor lot to begin with. I actually think that's one thing they, as a group, have over Myth. I just think the design language is a little more refined by this point. So having Mume contrast that was a good choice. Mume's most notable for going a tad... bananas every now and then. We've got another member that's officially the Guardian of Chaos later in this video, but Mume's been gunning for that crown since the start. Fine by me, any person who can be totally unfazed by horror yet find balloons popping to be the most terrifying thing in the universe is someone who's going to stick with you. I don't have much more to say about Mumes. She's another decent member of Hollow Council. I'd say if you like your VTubers to come with an extra helping of batshit, check her out. Don't be surprised if she isn't quite what the legends say of her, though. VTuber rating, balloons popping, out of 10.
I'm gonna keep saying tomato, but I'm gonna start saying potato now.
So I mentioned back with Gura that I used to have a problem with voices in VTubers. I thought they were distracting and I didn't see the need for them. While I've since come around to them a tad more, I still struggle to think of anyone who really benefits from doing a voice more than if they just spoke naturally. That said, there is one member who might come close. Her name is Fauna, and she's the best. I mean, that's a bit of an exaggeration. She's not even my favorite council member, because I don't think her greatest hits are quite up there with the perfection that is peak Crony. But Fauna is more or less the one I'm always in the mood for, no matter what. Even I'll admit that toxic levels of Crony exposure are a very real thing. Fauna, though, I just never get tired of. As for her voice, I really don't know what it is, since it's not like Fauna's is any less exaggerated than the others, but it just works so well whenever she does it. On top of it just being a nice, pleasant sound to listen to, it's really no wonder why she does a lot of ASMR, I think it's just how natural it sounds. I mean, you know there's no way in hell this is actually what she sounds like on a day-to-day basis, but I think I'm just more willing to go with it than I am with some of the others for reasons that honestly elude me. That's just her voice, though. How's the rest of Fauna? Well, as far as lore goes, she's got one of the simpler ones to explain. She's basically just Gaia. I'm sorry, was that too simplified? I'll expand on it more. She's a humanoid female personification of Earth, literally Mother Nature, because metaphor, so, yeah, she's Gaia. All right, not as much to the backstory on this one, but if you haven't caught on by now, my stance on that is, I don't know, whatever, who cares? Fauna has more to offer than just her natural ways. Along with her generally quite pleasant demeanor and chill vibes, I guess, Fauna also surprisingly brings it in the humor department. Even compared to her gen mates, it's easy to just categorize her as the mommy of the group, lots of people do, what with her soft, calming voice and literally being Mother Nature, but what defines a great VTuber is whether or not if you stripped away all their gimmicks and all that external BS, if you still think you'd watch and enjoy them. And I think Fauna nails it in that regard. Fauna, like Ina, is someone I've been on quite the journey with when it comes to how I feel about her. While at first I felt myself really clicking with her, then grew to be a bit disillusioned later on, I think at this point things have averaged out and I can earnestly say that I like her. I don't know if she's a super favorite of mine, but she's got her appeal, she's versatile, she looks cool, if I forget to mention that with any member, just assume it's a given. And when I'm in the mood for her, I think she delivers the goods. VTuber rating, out of 10.
Hey, crony.
Ow!
As much as I feel like I've given each member thus far their due diligence without dragging things out too long, one could argue that I'm really just being surface level. But that's gonna be hard for these next two council members, because for them, the surface is off limits. Instead, we've gotta dig deep, deep down to the land down under. Hakos Bales is the guardian of chaos and also a rat. Simple enough. I'd say you could easily guess that she'd be an embodiment of chaos with that outfit, and that's one of Bae's highlights. Her design is awesome. It's really colorful, but not an eyesore. It's detailed without being too busy, and it matches her gimmick without being too obvious. Unless you count the big rat lettering on her chest, but that's just cute. Like with Iris, Bae is someone who has plenty of things going for her, and I can understand why someone else may like her a lot. But I can't say I'm in that boat. It's tough, because it's not like I hate Bae, she's just a little too much for me. The loud, fast-talking shtick isn't dead on arrival, but like I said when talking about Kiwawa, it has to feel genuine, and I'm not sure it does with Bae. Bae's at her best when she just slows the hell down and chills the fuck out, which, to be fair, has become more common over time. And that seems to be a pattern amongst people who try to force an energized persona where it doesn't belong. Actually, Holoe in itself has a pretty good clip to help illustrate my point.
Hold on, let me try to sound more excited.
Yeah, let's go! Oh my god, look at this! Look at this cube! Oh, nice! Let's go! Oh my god, it's so shiny! Oh, let's go!
See? Not so funny what happens to you, huh, Bae? I suppose me talking about Bae like she's a hyperactive child is fitting, since there's an ongoing joke among the viewers that Bae is a zoomer, and as a result doesn't get a lot of the references that the other members make. This is one of those instances where I genuinely can't tell if the audience is just having a goof, or if they actually think that Bae's age is somehow an explanation for her not getting these things. What it seems like to me is that she was just living under a rock for most of her life and has a lot of catching up to do when it comes to pop culture. Which isn't uncommon, but it's odd that everybody makes it about her age. Even if it had some justification in the beginning, I think people are still taking it too far. It's not even like she's that young anyway, at least I can't imagine she is. Younger than her gen mates? Maybe, but people talk about her like she's 8, it's really weird. Also, for an additional note, for the supposed guardian of chaos, Bae's not very chaotic. She might be one of the more normal council slash promise members at the end of the day, which, again, makes me glad she started dropping her gremlin act more often. With all that said, I don't hate Bae. We're all gonna have different preferences and people that appeal to us more than others, and that's part of what makes Hololive so great, is that there is such a wide variety to choose from, and that you don't have to be a fan of everyone to still belong in the viewer base. Really, if we want to talk about these people in the grand scheme of the greater YouTube ecosystem, then Bae being a personally less liked member of a very well-liked bunch is actually fairly high marks. VTuber rating, Glue Trap out of 10. That's terrible, why did I write that?
Callie, let me smell your feet!
For the final stop on our trip through council, let's go back a bit to celebrate a Holo University alumna. Tsukumo Sano was initially introduced as the fifth member of council. a massive guardian of space whose size equaled if not exceeded that of many celestial bodies, thus earning her the affectionate moniker of Big. Unfortunately, I wasn't able to really appreciate Sana while she was around. I think I came aboard a little too late, but that's okay, this is what VODs are for. Sana isn't my favorite council member, but I overall think she was a perfectly fine addition who complimented her genmates well. Sana always seemed like a good example of childlike in the best ways possible. Her sheer enthusiasm is what makes her special. While I can't say she was the funniest, you could make the case that she was the funnest. And listen, one of the appeals of Halloween is that secondhand enjoyment you get just from watching people have fun, and I think Sana was a really good poster child for that. One thing that always struck me about Sana was her relationship with Ina. You see, while most of the members didn't know each other prior to getting the VTuber gig and pretty much met through Hololive, Ina and Sana were actually good friends long before either even thought about becoming VTubers. It really shows in their interactions that the two had a great rapport with one another that only comes around after knowing someone for many years. I think that's generally one of the things that's only gotten better with time for all of Hololive English, and something that can only be achieved through extended exposure. The longer the girls have spent with each other and the more they become good friends in addition to being co-workers, the more entertaining and refined their dynamics have become. Speaking of dynamics, whenever Sana was with the council members, it was always fantastic. She really knew how to bring the best out of her groupmates during any big collab, and her joyful presence was something that carried over into nearly every possible outlet. Solo streams, duo streams, group streams, songs, you name it. So yeah, I do like Sana, and I wish that I could have had a bit more time to appreciate her in the present, but it's not like her old streams or clips are going anywhere anytime soon. They'll always be there, and that's great. But I can't help but feel troubled somehow. In my mind, the sad truth of the matter is that, assuming Hololive maintains relevancy for the next several years, people just getting into it in the future will know Sana first and foremost as the one who left, which really isn't fair to her. She's far from my favorite council member, but I acknowledge there was more to her than just being the fifth one. She was a lot of people's favorite, and really struck a chord for reasons I don't find hard to see why. It's a shame it was so fleeting, and even more so where that emptiness now leaves us, but hey, her leaving wasn't all bad. It's what allowed Iris to slowly assimilate herself into Council, which ultimately led to the branch being rebranded as Promise, and including Iris as a full-time member, so maybe there's a bright spot to everything. Beyond that, the one thing that continues to impress me above all else with Sana is just how much of a presence she still has after graduating. I still see her cropping up in animations and clip compilations. She's far from forgotten, and I think it's cool that the fans have allowed themselves to keep her in their minds even though she's no longer streaming. It may even lend credence to the idea that Sana really is eternal. VTuber rating, big out of 10.
That doesn't make sense. Shut the bloody hell up.
Holo Advent just debuted earlier this year, and in the short amount of time they've been on the roster, they seem to have successfully won over a grand majority of the hearts, minds, and private regions of the Holo-ian fandom, as to be expected. Now, this generation is admittedly special for me, as it was the first one I got to see the build-up towards play out in real time. I was there to witness the initial announcement, reveal of all the new members' designs and lore, and finally their full debuts as they happened. And if all of that wasn't enough, I am proud to say that I did watch the debut streams of Nerissa and Fuomoko live. Another cool thing that comes with them being the latest generation is that by the time they debuted, Hololive English had already been around long enough that many of the new members are fans who had hopped aboard during the earlier days of Halloween, and probably never in a million years thought they'd actually be able to join them, and that their idols would one day become their partners. So, hey, if it happened to them, it can happen to you, right? With that in mind, who better to kick off the Advent portion of the video than the first member I saw debut live? Nerissa Ravencroft. You know how when I was talking about Bae, I said that there wasn't anything wrong with her? She was just a little too much for me personally? That's more or less how I feel about Nerissa as well. I can't say there's anything about her that's bad. She's just not my type, for lack of a better term. But okay, as is customary at this point, let's not get too deep into my thoughts without going over her lore first. Pretty much all the Advent members have a similar background, even more interconnected than that of previous generations. The theme running through all of Advent is... prison. Yeah, maybe could have used a couple more drafts on that one, Hololive, but who really cares at this point? The basic idea is that all the Advent members were sealed away after committing some sort of crime, but after being imprisoned, were able to break out and, you guessed it, become live streamers. In Nerissa's case, she was brought up on charges of singing. No, really, that's what she was sentenced for. I mean, granted, her singing had the ability to drive others to madness, but it doesn't sound as stupid when I put it that way. Anyway, we've got her here now, and the results are... so-so. I don't exactly know what it is that makes me tune out from Nerissa more than some of the other members I don't like as much. Usually I'm able to better put together what it is that doesn't grab me about them, but even sitting here writing this video, I can't quite place my finger on what I don't like so much about Risa and her persona. Maybe it's just because I don't really see much in her that I can't find somewhere else. I already said Iris was the queen of yabai moments and that she had a magic with them that somehow made it work. When Nerissa does it, I just don't find it as amusing. This is especially apparent when looking at her genmate Shiori. I'll have time for her later in this video, but to say she's just as, if not more, lewd than Nerissa, I could safely say I like it a lot more when she does it. It's a shame too, since, as to be expected by this point, all of the things you'd want in a Hololive talent are still present in Nerissa. She's got a good design, a magnetic presence, and a rich, easy listening voice. I really never knew I needed a VTuber with a Midwestern twang, but here we are. I'll always have a place in my heart for Nerissa since she was the very first HoloEN member I got to see debut live. But in terms of ones I'm actually gonna return to time and time again, there's a lot of other ones higher on the podium than her. But hey, at least she's old enough that me and her are on the same level when it comes to our pop culture knowledge. See, I can find things that I like. VTuber rating, Commando out of 10. And now it's time for the twins. Yup, they're twins. Did I mention they're twins yet? They sure are twins. Look, it's a video of them speaking in sync.
1,000 rooms!
Wow, aren't you so glad I showed you that? Okay, I've gotta be honest. Really, the one thing I have to say that I think everyone can get behind with Fuwawa and Mokoko, those are their individual names, the account's name is just a portmanteau, is the gimmick of two talents sharing a single account and virtually always streaming together. That's a cool idea that's executed about as well as you'd hope it would be, and it even makes a lot of sense. Lots of people like collab streams more than solo ones. Hell, for some people, it's all they watch, so why not have a channel that's a constant collab and has that baked into its premise? Having them be twins is reason enough in-universe. Having them be dogs is... certainly a choice. Not sure why I included that. And speaking on the designs, I like that they weren't lazy and just did a cut-and-paste job with them. Fuwawa and Mokoko have distinct... everything. Different hair, different eye color, different body types, different fashion sense. Would it be fair to assume then that they're fraternal twins, not identical ones? So while the initial gimmick is cool, that's all it is. A gimmick. And everyone's so in love with it that why wouldn't they play into it as much as possible? I mean, it feels like half the clips I see are just of them doing twin stuff. That's fine if that's enough to tide you over. Me personally, I'm looking for a little more. And Fuwamoko themselves are okay, but I'm not gonna hand out points just cause they got a neat setup. In a lot of ways, they're very much a VTuber's VTuber. They do all the things you expect them to. They both have distinct, high-pitched voices, interesting designs, lots of cuteness abound. Really, take away the twin thing and they're both just hitting that baseline that, by this point in HoloEN's history, you'd hope would be aiming a little higher then. With that said, again, I should count my blessings here and say that they're not annoying or really all that cringe inducing. Though to be fair, some people find the idea of VTubers in general cringe inducing, so I guess I can thank my high tolerance for that. I do think their voices can slip a little into the former category. That's honestly my biggest gripe with either of them. At the end of the day, Fuwamoko, I don't love them, but there's something there. They do score points for giving us possibly the greatest rendition of Axelef or Crazy Frog that has ever existed. That on its own is worth checking out. Outside of that, they're just kind of alright. VTuber rating, twins out of 10. Koseki Biju, or Bibu as virtually everyone started calling her after like a week, is about as entertaining as staring at a rock. Yeah, I know, pot calling the kettle black, and the best part was, I didn't even mean that. I was just trying to fit in a stupid rock joke, cause, you know, Bibu's a rock, or crystal, or whatever, and everyone always references that, and I thought I could join. I'm just gonna move on. Bibu is another member I don't have a ton to say about. I'll say this much, for as easy as it is to just refer to all the towns in Hollowbeen as cute, Bibu is the first one for me where I find that to be the primary descriptor that comes to mind. All the other ones usually have one or two more sentiments that pop into my head before that. With Bibu, nah, she really is just cute. Not that that's a bad thing, there's certainly worse things you can be than cute. It just doesn't give me much to expand on, since I don't really see the point in dragging this on when all you really gotta know is that she's cute. Okay, Biju or Bibu or whatever hits that sweet spot similar to Fauna, where she can do a clearly put on character voice and have a way to not make it annoying. It's really kind of a marvel since her voice is arguably the most artificial in all of Hollowbeen, other than maybe the twins, but it doesn't bother me at all because she does such a good job at retaining it and never having it slip. You just sort of let up and give into your suspension of disbelief after a while. I haven't been bringing that up as much as I thought it would throughout this video. Suspension of disbelief. My guess as to why is that it seems fairly apparent from the outset that you have to approach the idea of VTubers with a certain just go with it attitude that I think members like Bibu work well within. I can't find much to complain about with Bibu, nor can I find a whole lot to excessively rave about. I'm noticing that with some of these Advent members. They just kinda do what's needed and don't shoot much higher. To try and find a way to spin that in a positive sense, you could perhaps consider them the workman-like Hollowbeen generation. They're the real article, what you see is what you get. Is anybody gonna get that reference? Nerissa probably would. Wait, I'm still supposed to be talking about Bibu, aren't I? She's alright. Once again, you just sort of get what you get with her, but I think that's fine. VTuber rating, The Rock out of 10. Shiori Novella was technically the first Hollow Advent member to debut, but I'm featuring her last to stick to the old tradition of saving the best for such a placement. Oh yeah, I'm going in guns blazing with this one. Because I actually kinda can't believe how much more I like Shiori than her genmates. Now that is not to disrespect them in any way, they're all fine, but Shiori really is the only one I find myself actually watching a fair amount from time to time. She's got everything you'd hope would come from your standard talent package, though nothing too noteworthy in that regard either. As others have pointed out, it's quite amusing how gothy she is. That was one of the things that I felt like I couldn't stop seeing shortly after debut, and I mean the dark palette and the hair and everything certainly gets that across. I honestly don't mind it and I think she looks pretty cool. Plus, it's something a little different that I'd say we hadn't seen as much of, and you know how I love variety, so she's got that to bring to the table. I also personally appreciate the vocal dissonance on display, with her having a squawky, high-pitched voice that you wouldn't immediately assume coming from how she looks. On that note, said voice is yet another exception that proves the rule of me actually liking a VTuber voice and not finding it annoying or distracting. But outside of that, I don't know what it is, in the same way I couldn't entirely place what I didn't like about Nerissa. There's just some kind of magic to Shiori that makes me really enjoy her, even if I'd swear I wouldn't. It's kind of fitting that I would bring Nerissa into this, as for whatever reason I pick up a lot of synergy between them. Maybe that's just from their appearances both leading into the whole dark thing, but I can honestly say there really isn't another Hollowbeen member quite like Shiori, at least from what I've seen. She's her own unique beast, I guess sort of reminiscent of Ame. She can do the lewd thing better than almost anyone, I just don't think Iris has her beat in that aspect. And there's something about her presence and how she comes across that really clicks with me. Apologies if I'm coming across a little vague, but sometimes you just get a certain feeling and wording it is easier said than done. I mean, I kinda wasn't sure about Shiori at the initial outset, but over the handful of months that Advent has been around, she's the one I found myself returning to more and more often. Out of all the Advent members as of making this video, Shiori is really the only one to get her hooks in me. I want to make it clear that I haven't totally made up my mind on really any of the Advent Gen mates, but for the time being, Shiori stands tall above the rest as the closest Advent comes to measuring up to the previous generations. VTuber rating, Hot Topic, out of 10.
They don't really have a lot of time to get to know each other. I'm pretty sure they banged within like the first few days.
You know what though? For as all around mixed as my thoughts on Hollow Advent are individually, at least when they come together, they're fun. So, yay for teamwork. Anyway, that's it. That's all of them. It's the end of the video. I'm finished. You can go now. Except no, because I still have 8 more members to talk about. Why did I purposely go out of order and save them for last? And what makes them so different from the other members? Well, I'll let How I Met Your Mother explain that one.
That's a penis.
Hollowstar is English, more specifically Hollow Tempus, or just Tempus, or the Tempus Boys, that's my favorite, debuted in 2 halves. The first 4 members, consisting of Altair, Magni, Axel, and Vesper, all debuted in July of 2022. Roughly 5.5 months later, members Betel, Flayon, Shinri, and Haka also joined the roster. I've heard that it was originally only going to be 6 members and 2 more were tacked on later, thus forcing them to spread out their debuts, but what ultimately mattered is that, in the end, all 8 members were assembled. For at least a little while, but we'll get to that when we get to that. For now, I have to mention that although they debuted in mid-2022, like all branches, Hollow Tempus was announced far earlier, and unlike the other groups I've talked about, as far as I'm aware, Tempus was the first one to receive some amount of resistance on launch. I can't imagine why. But seriously though, I do think that has something to do with it. There were other complaints brought up, like the designs. I honestly don't see anything wrong here, but one other reason I've heard thrown around, not by the most reliable sources mind you, is that people didn't like that the Tempest members were going to be able to collaborate with the girls. I know, right? Oh god, oh the humanity! Yeah, if it wasn't obvious, I find a lot of the backlash directed at Tempest before they even debuted to be pretty stupid and unsubstantial. Even the more understandable claims, like the designs being bad. First of all, I'm no character designologist, but I really don't see anything that atrocious here. Granted, Gen 2's designs are better, but we'll get to them. But more to the point, who really cares if their designs or lore or whatever is lackluster? All of that is just framework for the more important stuff, like their personalities, or their senses of humor, or their talents, or how they interact with one another. That's what you watch the girls for, right? Right. That is why you watch them, correct? No. No, don't tell me. Well, anyway, rant over with. Let's talk more about Tempest. Regis Altair is the canonical leader of the Tempest Guild, who debuted on July 22nd, 2022. What's the Tempest Guild? I don't know. I don't even know if they ever actually explain it. I think the kind of people who would even be interested in Hollow Stars are the same ones who have a fuck it, who cares attitude towards the, Hololive mythos, so I guess it's fitting that we gloss over that. Something I won't gloss over is that we have an entire generation of Hololive, or Hollow Stars, made up of humans. We've had canonically human genmates in the past, but never an entire grouping of them, which is kinda cool. But as for Regis himself, he's pretty alright. He makes for a decent frontman to the Tempest Boys, and although I like some of the other members more, I still think Altair was the perfect choice for being the leader, kinda, since in some ways he's the most idolesque Tempest member. Which is saying next to nothing, but you take what you can get. What I mean by that is he seems the most like a member of Hollow Live, not a Hollow Star. Though this was more evident toward the beginning, to be fair. I think if you've only watched Hollow Live English and haven't had much interest in Tempest, Altair might be a good jumping off point for that reason. The big issue I have with him, and the thing that leads to him getting outshined by his co-stars, see what I did there? Co-stars, like co-Hollow Stars, I know, I'm a hack, you don't have to tell me, is that his own approachability is kind of his downfall in that he's just a tad vanilla. Like, he's there and he's got his moments and sometimes he's pretty funny, but the competition in all those areas is so fierce that I feel like he, ironically, seeing as how he's the leader, falls behind and is sort of bringing up the rear in that aspect. It could have been worse. He's not quite as bland as his initial presentation might make him out to be. He compliments his group and whoever else he shares the stream with well. His voice is very soothing, that's the best way I can describe it, and as with just about all of them, there are a ton of exceptions to his standard persona that show us that he's not just a desperate gasp of say-so-ness from Hollowstars. He can hang with the big dogs too. Also, to add more strange dynamics to this weird-ass family tree we have going on, Regis, or Dragus, is sometimes characterized as a brother to Hololive Indonesia member Kobo, who herself has a running gag of being the child of Callie and Kiara, who themselves have a previously mentioned bit of being in a relationship, so would that make Altair Kiara and Callie's son? Why am I talking about this? Whatever. VTuber rating, Ragus out of 10.
Get a little kinks out of your neck. Oh, man.
Yeah. Oh, hey.
Thanks, bro.
Oh.
You need any healing?
No,
girls allowed. Oh, God. No girls allowed.
Come on, Dave.
Axel Sirios is... Actually, I never really got a solid read on what his role is. Something about being a gladiator? Okay, let's go with that. Whatever his position is, there is one thing that is indisputable about him, and that is that he is a dog person, or wolf or something, because the twins weren't enough. Actually, Axel debuted before Fuwamoko, but I'm doing them out of order, so for the purposes of this video, I'm stalling, I know. Anyway, Axel is fine, but I don't watch him as much as a lot of his co-Hollowstars, for reasons that I'm starting to see are common among the Holo-EN members I'm not as big a fan of. Like with Iris, Altair, Nerissa, and the like, it's not as if there's anything overly terrible about Axel, he's just sort of... well, there. Is that a consequence of me not watching him as much? Entirely possible, but that has a lot to do with me just not finding a lot to draw me to him. Also, it's not like with Advent where they haven't been around that long and most of the time they were I was busy writing this video. I saw Axel plenty before I started working on this and he still wasn't my favorite. Like with those other members, he at least has the decency to be a good companion to his gen mates, not be overly annoying or really anything to make me harbor any ill will towards the guy. As we get deeper into Tempest though, you'll find that there is a lot of competition in nearly every aspect of the VTubing sphere as it relates to this particular cohort. Just about anything that can be done right has so many people in the running for the top spot that it was inevitable that I'd have some falling behind in my mind. That may be the best way to sum up Axel. As a C student at Holo Academy, he's not gonna get held back or anything, but you can't exactly imagine him being the valedictorian either. I guess, if anything, it's just a testament to the general high quality of these guys and girls to begin with, that a somewhat weaker member like Axel is still streets ahead of some of the other
wonderful people
on this magical Eden of a website. I don't dislike Axel, but he is kind of featureless. He does his job, but for me there's nothing too special about him. And unlike with some other members, I don't feel like I'm being unfair that I haven't given Axel a chance either. He just doesn't do much for me. VTuber rating, Furry Foxtail out of 10.
I'm not a furry, okay? I'm say so.
Oh yeah, when I said there was stiff competition from the rest of Tempest, and that it was only natural that some other members would fall behind, that's because I was building up to something. Strap in, and I mean even more than you already are, because this one is quite the circus. Surely you jest, I hear you saying. Well, do I? Gavis Bettle is a member of Tempest Vanguard, which is a different subgrouping from the first Tempest section called Tempest HQ. Yeah, I'm going out of order again since I'm talking about all four Vanguard members before I cover the last two HQ ones. It'll make sense, I promise. Either way, Bettle is, get this, the jester of the Adventurers Guild. You know how I teased Advent earlier for having kind of a weak setup with the connective tissue just being prison? Well, having a group jester is definitely up there, but say it with me now, who gives a shit? Bettle is the best, he's just awesome. God, it feels good to gush about somebody again. I mean it too, this guy is peak. He may very well be my top three holo members ever because he, once again, feels like the best version of everything I like about his respective branch. Holostars has always had a bit more of an experimental feel to it, for lack of a better term. They all just feel so at ease and unrestrained here, like they could just do whatever they want because who cares? It's Tempest, there's no expectations, so they don't even bother fucking around and just decide to be entertaining. You kind of get the sense that it's rubbed off on some of the other gens too. Seems like everyone has loosened up a little over time. Betel really capitalizes on that, I find, and another reason why I like him so much is a bit of a counterintuitive one. Betel often doesn't feel like a VTuber. This is kind of a Tempest thing in general, but I mean, all the tropes and all the notions about VTubing and VTubers don't really apply to him, and that can either be seen as a positive or a negative. I see it as a good thing. For a point of comparison, he gives off more mid-2010s Let's Player vibes, which are not bad vibes to give off, and he's just funny. Actually really funny. To me. I feel like I should be saying that after every sentence. It's all to me this, and in my opinion that. You get it. You know it's all preference by now. Betel is another genmate I can just never see myself getting tired of. He's a genuine comedic talent, a good storyteller, a wonderful off-the-cuff speaker. He's got it all, and he's accessible. In short, he's Tempest's Callie. I like them both for similar reasons, but in all honesty, I think I might like Betel even more. VTuber rating. Out of 10. Yes, I know he's a jester, not a clown. Relax.
And then everybody that like would come in would just pee over me.
Machina X Flayon is the absolutely precious pilot of the Tempest Guild. Because having a small, predominantly red member worked out well enough for council that I guess they can do it here. That's right, Flayon, I see you cribbing base style. Actually, there's little similarity beyond that, not sure why I pointed it out. Anyway, I haven't drawn much attention to someone's design in a while, because I was saving it. Even though Betel looks pretty awesome too. Like I said, I think Vanguard's designs are generally better than HQ's. Flayon really stands out just because of how red he is. Like seriously, I can't think of another member other than maybe Gura who leans this much into a single color. As for Flayon himself, I think he's got some good moments and a lot of stuff I like, but I'm not sure he's an absolute mainstay for me. He's definitely got the unhinged part down. I know that's a common adjective for all the people in this video, but Flayon seems to go to greater lengths to make that more of a consistent thing, which I don't mind. I need a little crazy, we all do. And like with just about any trait that could become overdone, Flayon knows how to temper it, or rather, Tempest it. Oh, you wanted to laugh and you know it. He's also just cute. Again, another very commonly attributed descriptor that could apply to a lot of members, but much like with Bibu, Flayon is one of the only ones where I don't have much else that comes to mind before that one. With the others, I think of things like funny, crazy, enjoyable before I lean towards things like cute, but Flay is an exception. Is that a bad thing? Not at all. I mean, any positive feelings you can elicit from an audience one way or another is a win in my book. Also, the longer I go on, the more I know this is going to become yet another consistent trend, but like with most of Tempest, Flayon is also pretty funny even if he's not the strongest genmate in this aspect. Really, I'm fairly simple to entertain, and Flayon brings just enough of what I like to satisfy. He maybe isn't as consistently amusing as some of the others, but rest assured, he's still a cutie. I can't help it, it stands out. But outside of that, he's another okay Tempest member. VTuber rating.
Why the frick are you so cute?
Out of 10.
I'm going to break you myself.
Banzo and Haka is an exorcist. No, that's too obvious. Except I just did it. And I'm not changing it. Oh well, live and learn. Except I'm not learning. And am I really living? Oh well, maybe I'm just possessed. I can get Haka to help me out with that one. And I would absolutely want to because Haka's pretty cool. He strikes a good balance between being really loud and high energy, arguably the most out of any Tempest member, but never taking it too far and always feeling genuine, much like Kiara. Come to think of it, Kiara's a phoenix and Haka's got some pretty avian features himself. It's even funnier that I bring that up when you consider that I compared Betel to Callie, and that It Takes Two stream with Haka and Betel kinda reminded me of Takamori. I don't know where this is going, but it's here anyway. History rhymes, I suppose, even when it's fairly recent and close together YouTube history. While I do really like Betel and Haka together, Haka's also good with pretty much anyone, another mark of a quality talent. In addition, I know I've brought this up plenty of times, but I'm saving the best for last year. Haka's design is so fucking cool. I don't know what it is since he doesn't have the most showy appearance. He's more like crony in the sense that it's not overly colorful. Maybe it's the amount of purple, maybe it's the feathers, maybe it's the platform shoes, but I really like how this guy is designed. He has my favorite appearance in all of Tempest, and he definitely contend well with the other Hollow-EN members' best designs too. He's also a fluent Spanish speaker. I don't really have much else to add to that, other than I've been neglecting to mention everyone else's linguistic range so far in this video, so here's my chance to spotlight everyone. The only reason I'm doing it in Haka's section is to point out how odd it is that we, to my knowledge, don't have a Spanish-speaking branch of Hololive yet. Isn't that weird? Hell, we got Hololive Indonesia before we got Hololive Spanish. I'm sure there's a reason for that. But I'm too lazy. I'm not too lazy to say that Haka is one of the better Hollow Tempest members in my eyes. Not that I couldn't say that without being lazy, but semantics. In addition to his excellent design, he also features a great, vibrant on-screen presence, and did I mention he also sings metal? I'm not a huge metalhead myself, but you know by now how much I love variety. And like with Callie being a rapper, I can't say I've seen that before. And just like Narissa showed me what I never knew I needed, a Hololive streamer with a deep Midwesterner accent, Haka opened my eyes to yet another dialect I've been seriously underestimating. As if Iron Mouse wasn't able to do that job already. VTuber rating, spicy Latino boyfriend out of 10.
I just fucking heard fucking died.
Shinri. Okay, I'm probably not gonna go very long with this guy. First of all, lore. He's a Ronin. Got that? Fantastic, let's continue. There's been a bit more negativity in this video than I intend for there to be, and once again, it's not that I don't like Shinri, I just don't have much of an opinion on him one way or the other. One thing no one is gonna contest is that he's got an awesome, deep voice. I think this is another one who is mostly saved by his timbre. Of course, there's more to say about him than that, like how he's canonically the second oldest member in Hollow Tempest, behind Flayon, of course, who's like 18,000, but honestly, I wouldn't put too much stock in the lore ages anyway. Supposedly, in-universe Shinri is older than Vesper, but I'll be getting to that later. My point is that Shinri, at least out of the Vanguard members, is the one I can actually believe being the oldest IRL, which probably means he isn't, but the observation still stands. He's certainly on the quieter and more subdued side, and while I've enjoyed other members in the past for that reason, Shinri just doesn't really stick the landing in this approach as much as someone like Ina does. He's okay, but there isn't as much going on to really suck me in and make me watch him over anyone else. I can't think of much that makes me say, oh yeah, Shinri, I gotta see him play that. He'd offer something that no one else can. And I know I'm being kind of a dick for even saying that, since, like, that could just be who he is. In fact, that's more likely than not. So I'm basically just saying I don't like someone's IRL personality, and you know, that's kind of a shitty thing to do, but this far into the video, I gotta be honest and I gotta be fair. And I have to say that, right alongside Axel, Shinri is one Tempest member that I don't find myself coming back to much. With that said, there are a couple things I like. It's nice to get someone with a slower, quieter approach. As much as I love the high-energy enthusiasm of some of Shinri's gen mates, I understand that having everyone be like that can be a little much, so just having Shinri there may be neat for some people. I also like how giggly he is. There are entire compilations of Shinri's wheezes, and I'm less surprised than I should be that those exist, but again, a bright personality without being really hyper is a neat combination. There's plenty to like about Shinri, but you know, stiff competition, people get left behind even if there's nothing really wrong with them. VTuber rating, out of 10.
I have like 2 postgraduate degrees.
And now, to shine a spotlight once more on the alumni of Hollow University. Magni Desmond is the resident, supposed, alchemist of the Tempest Guild. He's got lots to offer all around. Lots of arms, lots of copium, and lots of people going, you know, maybe I've been sleeping on Hollow Stars. That's because Magni and Noir Vesper were well known for collaborating with the Hollow Live genmates much more than their fellow Tempest Guild members. They especially had a fun thing going with Crony and Callie, where they got up to all kinds of wacky hijinks.
Stop talking!
Oh, shit!
Oh, this bullshit!
Either way, back to Magni, these collabs with the Council and Myth members were certainly how I found out about Hollow Stars English, as it opened up a bright new world of VTubing for me to explore. Suddenly, I found it wasn't such a female-dominated sport after all. But far be it from me to just say Magni and Vesper were the first Tempest members I watched, they're also still some of the best. Starting with Magni, trying to come up with things I like about this guy is tricky, since I'd be much better off just rattling off what I don't enjoy about him. Of which there is next to nothing. His personality, his sense of humor, his range, in terms of being totally watchable on his own, but also having the best brought out of him when he's paired up with someone or in a group. Any of this sounding familiar? He's another Gold Star member that I simply can't find much fault in. He has everything. He's not the most in-your-face genmate, but that's okay, I think we could all use a little bit of subtleness. But it never gets too drawn out. He has his moments of being off his rocker, and kind of like Altair, I think Magni makes for good entry-level viewing if you're just giving Tempest a shot. I like Magni a little more though, mostly out of personal preference, but I feel like Tempest HQ, yes, even Axel, were the best to debut first, as they supplied the most well-rounded Hollow Stars English experience possible, and then having the rest come aboard later on was good for adding that extra spice that the guild needed. Between all the different Tempest HQ members though, it was a very close race between Magni and who I'm going to be talking about next. For now though, all that really needs to be said is that Magni is absolutely first rate. He's a member that I haven't really had a ton of variation in my opinion on him through the months, really. I kind of started off liking him and ended liking him. There was never much of a dip where I said, I'm just not the biggest fan of Magni Desmond anymore. He kept my attention, was always a reliable face throughout his entire run with Tempest. He got me into it and made sure that, with the other members' help, I would stay there. And for that, I think he's pretty fucking awesome. VTuber rating, copium out of 10.
Hey, if you're still watching, tell your mom I'm gonna be a little late tonight. Stream's still going.
Noir Vesper, the only Tempest member to have a drastic design change a la Iris during his tenure. He didn't get to show off the new design for very long, but hey, a new design reveal stream is a new design reveal stream, so yeah, show it off for all it's worth. He's also the only member I can recall to have been stabbed twice, unless the rest of the roster isn't telling us something. Or the rest of Hollow Live English for that matter. Whatever you could glean from any of that, Vesper is another really entertaining Hollow EN member that I am very grateful I was able to enjoy for as long as I was. Remember what I said about not really trusting the canon ages for these guys though? Well, Vesper was supposedly 28 at the start, but lots of people speculate, unless it was confirmed at some point, that he's actually a fair bit older than that. I'd believe it, especially with everyone referring to him as Grandpire all the time, because he also kind of looks like Alucard, but that is the furthest thing from a negative. As I've been stating throughout this whole video, we need variety, and having Hollow Stars even exist at all and be allowed to interact with the girls was plenty of it. But then we had Vesper, a comparatively older guy, being amongst the ranks, and that just opened the door for so many great interactions, of which there were a lot. Vesper had a great rapport with just about anyone. He fits more into that low-key kind of vibe that Shinri does, but I like Vesper's rendition a bit more. I can't really explain, but I do know that Vesper always had such life and really a great deal of charisma about him for supposedly being so stoic. I can't talk about Vesper without mentioning his, let's call it, playful rivalry with Crony. Every time these two were on screen together, it was sheer bliss. Even though I like Magni and Callie, we all know that even when it was the four of them together, it was more or less the Crony and Vesper show. And I know I shouldn't assume too much about the talent's personalities off stream, but I can't overstate how much of a kind, humble guy Vesper always struck me as. I haven't been giving much lip service to how nice these people seem so far, but Vesper just seeming like a genuinely good dude under all that rigging software stood out to me. He had one of the best debut streams ever. Sometimes they can come off a little awkward, but his was the best with his peeling the film off new electronics tale. Seriously, I could listen to him tell stories all day. Vesper was a class act. You'd swear he was my favorite, but I honestly don't even know about that. He's just the one I feel the most passionate about, and seeing the amount of support he and Magni and the rest of Holostars got, especially from people that were a little skeptical at first, it just warms my heart to no end. VTuber rating, peeling the film off of new electronics, out of 10.
While you were out having premarital sex, I studied the blade.
Well, that was a lot. I'm sure you're probably wondering how I plan on wrapping up this video, and I actually thought of a pretty succinct way of capping it all off. A ranking, of course. Yep, you heard me, I'm going to be going through every branch of Holo EN and ranking each member from least best to most best. Starting with Holo Myth. Number 5, Ame. Number 4, Ina. Number 3, Kali. Number 2, Kiara. Number 1, Gura. Holo Myth, for me, has the best average of all the Holo branches, as even Ame, who I put in last place, would still contend pretty well with some of the top spots in later rankings. As much as I like the other branches a lot, as of right now, Hololive English seems to be following the trend that you can't beat the original. Holo Promise / Council. Number 6, Bay. Number 5, Sana. Number 4, Iris. Number 3, Mume. Number 2, Fauna. Number 1, Crony. While I ultimately feel that Promise as a whole doesn't measure up to Myth, there are definitely some real standouts here. I love Crony, and even Mume and Fauna definitely have their appeal. The rest, though kinda hit and miss, are still plenty of fun to watch if you just sit back and enjoy. Skipping ahead to Advent, number 4, Nerissa. Number 3, Fuumoko. I don't prefer one over the other. Number 2, Biju or Bibu. And by quite a wide margin, number 1, Shiori. It honestly doesn't even feel fair to compare these 5 to the other branches since they're fairly recent, but for right now, I'll say that aside from Shiori, none of the members have really blown me away, but that doesn't have to be forever. I'm sure it took some people a bit to warm to Council and certainly Holostars, so maybe it's just the same phenomenon here. Reverse recency bias. The tendency to be harder on something that's new and different than something that's old, I mean, relatively, and familiar. Finally, Holo Tempus. Number 8, Axel. Number 7, Shinri. Number 6, Altair. Number 5, Flayon. Number 4, Vesper. Number 3, Haka. Number 2, Magni. Number 1, Betel. This one I'm really interested in seeing if it'll change following Magni and Vesper's graduation, considering both made it into my top 4. Will any other members be able to overtake them? Only time will tell. Should be the motto of this whole friggin' video if you ask me, but that just speaks to the kinetic and ever-changing nature of Hololive English and presumably all other branches. I don't have infinite time. Either way, while I can't say I know what the future holds for Holo EN, I will say that with Advent going off without a hitch, despite whatever I might think of them, more Holostars, something I can honestly say I was not expecting, and the fanbase seeming like it's bigger, happier, and healthier than ever, that said future, whatever form it takes, is a bright one. And even if that's not the case, I think the path that they have thus far left us with is definitely one worth celebrating. Any gripes I have with any of the members really are nitpicks, and most of them only came up after I pulled out a magnifying glass and tried to look for things I didn't like as much. That's just how I roll. There wouldn't be much of a video if it was just, I like her. I like her too, just not as much. Rinse and repeat until we reach the end. There, the final ass covering has concluded. I'm actually done now. You can go. Bye. Okay, fine, one more thing before I'm done. Clip channels. I love you, and your work was instrumental in the creation of this video, as well as getting me into Hololive in general. I mean, you guys sit through hours upon hours of streams from all different streamers just to clip out the best bits for people who don't have as much time on their hands to enjoy. It's wonderful. Your service is invaluable. I can't thank you enough. But holy hell, are your thumbnails the worst. I can't with them. If you know, you know, but I cannot stand the average clip channel's thumbnails. I understand too, YouTube, algorithms, gotta stay on top of things, gotta get people's attention, but every time I see one of them, it just fires on all the wrong cylinders in my brain and I want to not watch, which is probably the opposite of what the intended effect is. And with that, I think I'm finally done talking about Hololive English. Until I get around to the rest of the Hall of Stars. The mission is never truly over.
Well, that took a whole fucking hell of a lot longer to make than I thought it would. But okay, needless profanity aside, thank you all so much for being patient with me as I finished this video, and for still stopping by to watch it when all was said and done. And of course, to any new people who just found me as a result of this retrospective, I really hope you enjoyed it as well, and are looking forward to seeing more videos from me in the future. Your support is invaluable, your engagement is always appreciated. Thank you for watching, have a great day, and until next time, see ya.